around iPads, you know, and stuff. But we, it's sweet, not maybe as sweet, but we've got some candy bars for you as you leave the service, okay? This is like the comedic, you know, Sunday morning, I guess, for church. Anyway, God bless you guys, and continue being the men that God has called you and blessed you to be. We are in Matthew chapter 4 today, so let's go ahead and take our Bibles and we'll turn there if you haven't turned there already. Last week we were looking at John the Baptist. We were first introduced to him, and we saw the beginning of not only him coming and baptizing many in the Jordan River, but the beginning really of Jesus' ministry. It was like the initiation into his ministry. And then he came to John to be baptized by him. And remember, he said it's fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. It's similar to the priest at the age of 30 when they were initiated into the priesthood. They were ceremonially cleansed and they were anointed with the holy anointing oil. And so we kind of see a parallel in that, where Jesus is baptized and then the Holy Spirit comes down upon him like a dove, and then the affirmation from the Father, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." Now we find that the Spirit of God is leading Jesus into the wilderness where he will be tempted by the devil. He'll be out there for 40 days and 40 nights without eating anything. As we see the outline of chapter 4, the first 11 verses, the temptation of Christ, and then his ministry in Galilee, up in the northern region of Israel. We see him calling at least 4 of his disciples here in this passage, and then we've watched the crowds begin to follow him. This is going to lead us up to chapters 5-7, which is the Sermon on the Mount, which is where we'll be starting next week. And so here in the temptation of Christ, chapter 4, verse 1, "Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights afterward, he was hungry." It's interesting to note, isn't it, that it's the Spirit that's leading him into the wilderness. He's gone through this great time, I guess you would say, the initiation of his ministry as he begins in his baptism, and the Holy Spirit coming upon him, the affirmation again of the Father's voice from heaven. And now he's going off to this intense time of testing. The word tempt here in our passage is most often translated test in the New Testament. And I think it's the idea, the devil is there like the serpent in the garden to Eve. They're tempting Jesus, but he withstands every single time, and he becomes a tremendous example to us as we watch this, as he responds to the devil's temptations. Verse 3, "Now when the tempter came to him, he said, 'If you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread.' But he answered and said, 'It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God.'" Now there in the wilderness, again, 40 days without any food, and it tells us he became hungry. The devil comes and he says, "If you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread." Now, could he have done that? Did he have the power to do that? We know that he did, because a little later on, we're going to find him taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and multiplying them to feed over 5,000 people. So we know he could have done it. What is the first temptation? I think the idea here in the first temptation is for Jesus to provide for himself rather than being dependent upon his heavenly Father. The reason I think that is because of the passage that he quoted. He went right to the scripture, by the way. He says, "It is written," and he went back to Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3, which in its context, look at what it has to say within its context, Deuteronomy 8, 3. It says, "So he humbled you, allowed you to hunger, and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man shall not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that proceeds from the mouth of the Lord." This is the passage that's referring to Israel when they came out of Egypt, when Moses led them out and they're wandering in the wilderness and God provided for them. You remember the manna that fell from heaven. It would fall every day except on the Sabbath day. And so God was providing for them everything that they needed. And as they're going there in the wilderness, this is their time to depend upon the Lord and to trust in the Lord. And this is what Jesus would teach his disciples as well, what we refer to as the Lord's Prayer. He said, "Give us this day our daily bread." We're to have a daily dependency upon the Lord. We would like enough bread for the week, maybe the month, maybe the year, you know what I'm saying? But what would happen if we did that? If we had everything we needed, we would say, thank you, Lord, I'll be back when it runs out. And I think what the Lord wants with us is that ongoing relationship and ongoing dependency upon Him. You know, with our children, when we're raising our kids, they are completely dependent upon us as parents, aren't they? When they start out, completely dependent. But what do we do as parents? We are trying to make them independent of us. So when they get older, they can go out and they can get on their own. Independent of us, but dependent upon the Lord. We want them to learn how to trust God on a daily basis, to lead them and to provide for their needs. And so here, I think in essence, what the devil is doing, he's saying, go ahead and provide for yourself. And Jesus here, again, in his humanity, dependent upon his heavenly Father and showing us the example that we should follow, laying the example that we should follow in. We come to the next one in verse 5. Then the devil took him up into the holy city, set him on the pinnacle of the temple, and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written. Ooh, now the devil's quoting scripture, isn't he? I mean, first Jesus comes back quoting the scripture. This is why I'm not going to make these stones turn into bread. But now, did you know the devil knows the scripture? He does know the scripture, and he can use it against us. But he takes the scripture selectively, and he takes it out of context, as we'll see. And so the devil takes him into the holy city, which would be Jerusalem, because they're going to the temple. And he sets him on the pinnacle of the temple and said, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you. And in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. Jesus said to him, it is written again, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. Now, William Barclay, as it speaks of the pinnacle of the temple, where Jesus is on the pinnacle of the temple, tempted to be thrown down on the ground and let the angels just have him float down to the ground. William Barclay makes this comment that there were possibly two areas that could have been referred to here. One is on the temple platform area where the royal stoa met Solomon's colonnade. There was about a 450-foot drop to the Kidron Valley below. In Jerusalem on Mount Moriah, they built this retaining wall on the mountain so that they could fill it in. It's this large platform that the temple would stand upon, a large area for the people to gather. So there where the royal stoa meets the Solomon's colonnade, about a 450-foot drop, as William Barclay says, throw yourself down. The other spot would have been on the temple itself. And this is where the priest would go every morning. And on the top of the temple, he would look out and look for the dawning of the new day. When he saw the light, he would blow the trumpet and it would be the time for people to gather for the morning sacrifice. You can get the idea. Jesus is up there. Throw yourself down. Impress everybody how you can do the impossible. Exalt yourself in front of the people, I think we might say. Exalt yourself in front of the people as you jump off and come floating down and they go, ooh, look at you. Just a little application that I see in this. God has blessed us, every single one of us, with certain gifts and talents. And we have the temptation there to use them for ourselves, to magnify ourselves, or to magnify the Lord. And that's the thing we want to be careful of. We want to use what God has given us to bless and honor God. Now, the quotation that Jesus gives here, it is written, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. Again, he's going back to the law. He's going back to Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy 6:16 says, you shall not tempt the Lord your God as you tempted him in Massah. Now, Massah is the place, again, they're on their way out of Egypt. They've come out, they've gone through the Red Sea, but they don't have any water to drink. And so they're complaining to Moses, why did you leave us out here? Is God going to cause us to thirst to death? Is God among us or not? And that's when God instructed Moses to go to the rock, which God was standing upon, and hit the rock, and out of the rock would come that living water that would sustain 2 to 3 million people there in the wilderness. And so the tempting of the Lord, is God going to take care of us? And we see this throughout what's coming out throughout these temptations, whether it's the manna, the food to eat, whether it's the water, something to quench the thirst, they're concerned about what they're going to eat, what they're going to drink, maybe what they're going to wear. And remember, Jesus said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. And I think that's the idea. Get your focus on the Lord. God is going to take care of you. You don't have to question, is he really gonna provide or not? Don't put the Lord your God to the test. I had a story that I've shared before, but I wanted to share with you. The scriptures that can be taken out of context as we look at this passage here. First of all, with the devil, he's quoting Psalm 91. Jesus is going back to Deuteronomy. The devil is quoting Psalm 91. He shall give his angels charge over you. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. First of all, it's a selective passage. If he would have kept on reading, he would have read the part that said, you shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent you shall trample underfoot. Remember the serpent in the garden and the roaring lion seeking whom he may devour, both illustrating the devil. He kind of selectively just quoted the passage he had, but also out of context. That passage isn't saying you can live a reckless life and God will take care of you. It's simply a statement about God's love and his protection for his people. But it's not a license to live recklessly. Give you an example of a scripture. This scripture quoted out of context is when I was skiing years ago with my friend. We would go up to Mammoth Mountain, and we are at best, intermediate skiers in Big Bear, okay? Mammoth Mountain, they rate the runs completely differently. So we are on chair 23, going up to the top of the mountain, me and my friend, and notice the little black diamonds and the double black diamonds. Well, that's saying expert and really, really good experts go up there. And you see the blue down below, that's where we should have been, you know, at the most. But we're going up chair 23, and I'm thinking I'm out of my mind for even being on this chair with my friend who's driving me really to get on the chair and go up to the mountain. And as we're going over these chutes that are appropriately named Wipeout Chute, he's going, I'm going to go down that thing. Now, typically, you would ski to the left where it's a little bit wider. It's still steep, but it's a little bit wider, and you have a chance of at least not breaking your neck when you fall and tumble down the mountain. But there in the chute, you've got rocks on either side, so you have to cut it really sharp. So we're going up through there. He's saying, I'm going to go down that chute. And I said, you're out of your mind. He said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Here's a scripture that is quoted out of context, and that's the very chute right there. And the chair that's going up. And when you're on the top, it looks a lot steeper than it does right here. And so I ski off to the left-hand side, and he skis off to the right to go down the chute. I'm standing at the top for about 5 minutes wondering, why in the world did I come up here? How am I going to get down off this mountain? And about 5 minutes later, he comes skiing along the top of the mountain by me. And I said, hey, whatever happened to, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And he quotes this passage, actually this passage in context. And he goes, well, it also says, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. So a little lesson on scripture in and out of context here. As we come to the third temptation in verse 8, it says, again, the devil took him up on an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all these things I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. Then Jesus said to him, away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God and him only you shall serve. What he's doing here is he's offering him the crown without the cross. He's offering him the instant ability to rule over the nations and have all the glory of being the ruler, which he will. But he's offering him the crown without going to the cross first. And as I look at this and I think about the temptations that we have, that we're faced with, the instant gratification in our entitlement-driven society, you want it, you go get it right now. You want a truck, you get a loan. You want a new flat screen TV, you just put it on the credit card. You know, it's go out and get it now and worry about it later. It's a temptation, but even more so when we see this, it's the temptation to deny God and be unfaithful to him, to bow down and worship the devil. The devil offers us and he tempts us so much in the things of this world. And there are things that are tremendously tempting. We wouldn't be tempted by them if there wasn't some kind of satisfaction that would come from them. But would we really want to deny the Lord for the things that this world has to offer because they are so fleeting and so soon passing? Jesus said in Matthew 16:26, what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? Think about that for a moment. If you could gain, like Jesus is being offered, all the kingdoms of the world and their glory, and yet you would lose your soul forever, if you could have everything. And the thing about it is we're tempted by that, and we think that we would be happy if we had the things of the world, if we had the fame, if we had the money, if we had the party life. But if you think back just a little bit to your BC days before you knew Christ, there wasn't a whole lot of fun in that. And whatever fun there was, it was short-lived, wasn't it? Very fleeting. When you became a Christian, I'm venture to guess that your life changed dramatically, and it's been the best it's ever been. Not that you haven't gone through hard times, but you've got something now that you didn't have before. And that's a relationship with God. You've got the peace inside, even in the midst of the storms. And so he's a deceiver. That's the bottom line. He is a deceiver. He offers all of this, but you're totally robbed by it. I remember, again, a movie I was watching. I don't know, it's a long time ago. Alfred Hitchcock or The Twilight Zone or something like that. But the devil came to this man and offered him, I'll give you anything you want if you just sign your soul over to me. And he said, you know what? I want to be invincible, that no one could ever kill me. And the devil said, can do. And so sign on the dotted line. He signed on the dotted line. A little bit later, the guy's wife comes in and he's just, she's nagging. He takes her, it's kind of a graphic story here, he takes her and he throws her out the apartment window. She goes down and she dies. The police come, question him. Yeah, I killed my wife. They arrest him, take him to jail, and he's thinking, you know what? Let him give me the electric chair. I'm invincible. He stands before the judge. The judge says, guilty, life in prison without the possibility of parole. So he's invincible. He will live forever behind bars. That's the devil right there. He is a deceiver. He offers so much, but he rips us off in the process. And so here Jesus, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. The previous one, sorry. He says, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve. Let me quote it to you from Deuteronomy 6. It's not you shall worship, it's you shall fear the Lord your God and serve him. You shall fear him, fear and worship. Really talking about the same thing. To fear the Lord, the beginning of knowledge, the beginning of wisdom. To fear the Lord means to stand in awe of him, to reverence him, to acknowledge him for who he is, to worship him. And so the allegiance completely over to the Lord. Verse 11, then the devil left him, and beheld, angels came and ministered to him. Jesus resisted the devil, didn't he? In James 4:7, it says, therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Jesus sets before us the perfect example of being able to wield the sword of the Spirit. Remember Ephesians chapter 6, spiritual warfare, the armor of God, where we're to be clothed with the armor of God, the truth of God's word, the righteousness of Christ, faith in God, salvation that he brings us, to be clothed in that so that we can be able to stand against the tricks of the devil. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 13. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Notice the exhortation is to be strong, but not in your own strength, but to be strong in God. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. The wiles, that means the cunning craftiness of the devil. He wants to trick you. He wants to trip you up. Just think back again to the serpent in the garden. He wants to mess things up, makes it attractive, but then wants to reel you in. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Jesus gives us the perfect example of taking the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and when the enemy comes with his lies and his testings and his temptation, to be able to say, it is written, and to be able to stand upon the word of God. One of the things that we see through this passage is Jesus was tempted, as it says in the book of Hebrews, in all points as we are, yet without sin. As we read through the account in Matthew's gospel, it seems like he's there in the wilderness 40 days and 40 nights, and then the devil comes to him. Read the parallel account in Luke's gospel, and you find, well, this is what it says in Luke's gospel. Luke, it's back on page one. Luke 4, verses 1 and 2. It says that Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness being tempted for 40 days by the devil. Reads a little differently, doesn't it? Like the whole time he's there in the wilderness, he's being undergoing the temptations of the devil. So he knows what it's like to go through the pressure of temptation. So we know that he knows, so that when we go to him saying, God, help me with this situation, I'm having a hard time with it, we know that he can understand because he has been there. In Hebrews chapter 2, verse 18, it says, for in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to aid those who are tempted. He's able to give you the strength and able to give you the comfort that you need through those difficult times. Look at the beginning of his ministry here. You know, oftentimes we'll go off to a youth camp or a men's or women's retreat, and we're on the mountain, sometimes literally on the mountain, glorious time, and then we come down to the real world. We come down into the valley, and we're dealing with testings. And it's kind of similar here with Jesus as he has the beginning of this ministry where he's baptized, the affirmation of the Father, and then immediately into the wilderness as he goes through these testing times. Well, here comes the ministry. He passes the test. There's nothing that the devil has on him. And so he goes and he begins. Verse 12, now when Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, he departed to Galilee. And leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is by the sea, in the regions of Zebulun and Naphtali. After John had been put into prison, we'll read about that, the account of it, in Matthew chapter 14. After John the Baptist is put in prison, Jesus leaves Nazareth and he goes to Galilee. He leaves the place where Joseph and Mary were. He leaves the place where he grew up, and he goes to Galilee. Now, the Sea of Galilee is about 13 miles long by 8 miles wide. The region of Galilee is about 50 miles long and 25 miles wide. It was a densely populated area at that time. 200 plus towns, no less than 15,000 people in each town. So we're talking upwards of 3 million people where he begins his ministry, stationing himself in the northern part of Israel. And because of this, because of the population in the area, there's a unique opportunity to be able to minister to a lot of different people. You go down south to Judea, Jerusalem being the capital, the temple being down there. You go down there, it's an isolated area. A lot of Jewish people down there, but basically an isolated area. Galilee was on the crossroads. You had the roads that led north and south and the roads that led east and west. William Barclay makes this comment. The way of the sea led from Damascus through Galilee right down to Egypt into Africa, and the road to the east led through Galilee out to the frontiers. So he makes this comment that the traffic of the world passed through Galilee. Down in Judea, it's tucked away in a corner, isolated and secluded. As it has been well said, Judea is on the way to nowhere. Galilee is on the way to everywhere. So you have not only Jewish people, but this mix of a Gentile population and the things, if you'd say, the hustle and bustle of the world up there, where he sets his headquarters in Capernaum and begins shining the light of God's truth. And so, as we read on, he left Nazareth, verse 13, came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is by the sea, in the regions of Zebulun and Naphtali, two of the tribes of Israel in the Galilee area, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, quote, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And upon those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. Notice what Matthew's doing again. He's quoting the Old Testament to show that Jesus is fulfilling what Isaiah the prophet said about him. In verse 14, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet. The last couple of weeks, I've made the point that Matthew quotes the Old Testament some 50 times in his gospel. We have seen in this chapter already that Jesus has quoted the Old Testament 3 times. The devil has quoted the Old Testament. And here, Matthew is quoting the Old Testament. But notice again in verse 14 with the setting, that it might be fulfilled. As you look through the New Testament, or as you look through the book of Matthew, you'll find the approximate 50 times that he quotes the Old Testament. About 12 of those times, it's prefaced by that phrase, that it might be fulfilled. He's showing again that Jesus is the fulfillment of all of those Old Testament prophecies that spoke about him being the coming deliverer the Savior, the Messiah of Israel. And so here the passage from Isaiah chapter 9, where the region of Zebulun and Naphtali, again, the area of Galilee that we're talking, they're sitting in darkness, the deception that Satan has brought upon the world, the ruler of the world, the God, small g, of this age, the prince of the power of the air, the whole world lying under the sway of the wicked one. He has brought darkness upon the world, but now the light has come to those who sit in darkness. He has brought the light, the illumination of God's truth. In John 8, Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life." Verse 17, from that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." It's the same message, isn't it, that John the Baptist brought. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent, remember, it means to change your life. And it's based upon a change in attitude and thought concerning sin and righteousness. In other words, I've changed my attitude about what sin is and what righteousness is. It used to be that I was okay with sin. And the whole idea of living a righteous life, I don't want to do that. But now I've changed my attitude concerning that. And I've changed my thoughts concerning it. I now see that the way that I have been living is wrong. And I want to live the way God wants me to live. And so the change in attitude and thought has resulted in a change of life. That's the idea of repentance. Now we think about that when we become Christians and we think, man, that's a lot of work to do to try and live a good life. And it is a lot of work to do. But what we fail to remember is God is the one, when we become Christians, He is the one that puts those thoughts in our minds to do the right thing and not do the wrong things. He's the one that puts the desire deep down in our heart. I want to live for the Lord. And He's the one that gives you the ability, the power to be able to live for Him, to say no to the bad and yes to the good. The failure that I know I made in my Christian life is I was relying upon myself, thinking I need to do the right thing and not do the wrong thing. And I wasn't calling out to God and saying, God, I'm struggling in this area and I need help here. Please help me daily. Give us this day our daily bread on a daily basis to get that strength and direction. And therein is the Christian life, a relationship with God through His Son, Jesus Christ. And so repent, for the kingdom of heaven has drawn near to you in the person of Jesus Christ. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And so here He begins up in Galilee, and we see Him now calling His disciples. Verse 18, and Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Then He said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." They immediately left their nets and followed Him. So we're introduced to two brothers here, Peter and Andrew. We find from John's gospel that Andrew was actually a disciple of John the Baptist. So here we've got Peter and Andrew. They're both fishermen, but they're no longer to be fishing for fish. They're to be fishing for men. And so they're going to be out preaching the gospel, and they'll be out making disciples of all the nations. And notice their response. Jesus calls them, and they leave. They're out fishing. They're casting their nets. They leave their nets. It's a great picture of just surrendering over to the Lord. Their livelihood they've left behind, and they're following after the Lord. Now a couple more brothers, verse 21. Going on from there, He saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in the boat with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets. He called them. And immediately they left the boat and their father and followed Him. So we have Peter and Andrew, who are brothers, and now we have James and John, who are brothers. We find from Luke's gospel, chapter 5, that James and John were actually partners with Peter. So that's kind of neat, isn't it? So they have a fishing business going on. We find from Mark's gospel, Mark chapter 1, verse 20, that there were also hired servants in the boat. So James and John are not only leaving their livelihood, they're not only leaving their father behind, but they're probably leaving a wealthy business behind, having the hired servants there and all. It's a great picture of surrendering over to the Lord. Now, what did it get them? Well, James, he was the first of the 12 to be martyred for his Christian faith. And John was able to live the longest and ultimately would die, not martyred, but ultimately would die. That's looking at it from a worldly perspective. When you look at it from a spiritual perspective, what did it gain them? They got to be with Jesus. You know, they got to be the people that Jesus used to spread the gospel to the end of the earth. This is a great picture of surrender. I've never met anybody who regretted becoming a Christian and surrendering their life over to the Lord. You know, I've never met anyone like that. I haven't felt that way myself as far as my life goes. It doesn't mean that it's been perfect and there hasn't been hard things that have happened, but I wouldn't trade the life that I have now. And I venture you would say the same thing. I wouldn't trade the life that I have now for anything in the world. It has been so much better because Jesus has been in my life, in your life as well. Amen. And so the life surrendered over to him is the best life that anybody could ever possibly live. A life of surrender. And that's the real key there. Giving your life over, whatever it is, everything that I have, Lord, it's yours. I want to follow you wherever you want me to go. I made the point, I think last week or the week before, that here Jesus comes to the world, the Savior of the world, the Son of God, the Savior of the world. And he wasn't born in a royal palace. He was born in a stable because there was no room for him in the inn. And when the forerunner came, it wasn't the high priest that came on the scene going, "Behold, the Son of God has come to you." It's this burly guy out in the wilderness that's eating locusts and wild honey that's announcing the coming of the Messiah. And here we see when he is going to take his message and entrust it to be spread to the rest of the world, he doesn't go to the rabbinic schools. He doesn't go to the seminaries of his day, but he goes and he gets ordinary people. Ordinary people that are with him and know him and can spread the word. I love the passage in Acts 4 where Peter and John are arrested by the Sanhedrin, the religious leadership. And it says that when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled and they realized that they had been with Jesus. That was the key thing right there. They had spent time with Jesus, therefore they had something to give. They were ministering out of the overflow, and that's really the key. It's the key for every one of us. And I'm all for education. It is not about the education we have. It's about the time we spend with Jesus. We can have all of the knowledge in the world concerning the Word of God, but if we're not in relationship with the Lord, we really don't have anything to give. It's out of the overflow of our time spent with the Lord that we can give of his heart to other people and have an impact on the world. These guys that are brought, fishermen, I think it's a neat how they took their livelihood, what they did. Jesus took it and turns it around. You're no longer going to be fishing for fish, but you're still going to be fishing. But now you're going to be fishing for souls, the souls of men. And there's parallels that we see in the characteristics of these. My grandpa was a fisherman that loved to fish, and it takes patience to fish. As a little boy, I did not have what it took. I was good for about 20 minutes, maybe 30 on the shore. For my grandpa, fishing was sitting there the whole day. Didn't matter if he caught anything or not. That was fishing. You know, he was on the shore, and his pole was there, and he was just watching it. Patience is what it takes when you're fishing for men, because you don't see results right away. Oftentimes, you're the one planting the seeds, maybe watering the seeds, and it's very seldom that you're the one who's actually leading someone to the Lord, but you're still investing in them. You're still fishing. You're still putting those seeds, planting those seeds, and watering them as well. It takes perseverance. It takes choosing the right bait. My grandfather, you know, depending upon the lake, it might be worms. It might be Velveeta cheese with the little fish eggs. I liked it when it was the Velveeta cheese. Worms didn't go over good with me, so you have to have the right bait. What does that tell us? Well, as we're trying to reach out, our message stays the same, but our methods, the way we communicate that message, oftentimes it changes. You're trying to reach a group of young people, oftentimes a pipe organ and the hymns are not going to relate or grab the audience, but you start doing something that can lay that foundation that you can build upon. Like Paul said, "I've become all things to all men that I might by all means save some." Your message doesn't change, but your method in how you go out and you lay that platform so that you can share and preach the gospel, it does change so that we can be able to do that. Now we see the multitudes coming to him. Verse 23, it says, "And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease among the people. He is teaching, he is preaching, and he is healing. The difference between the preaching and the preaching means to herald forth a message. It's shouting forth a message. And the message that we shout forth today is the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the good news that he died in our place and he rose victorious from the grave to show that he is the savior of the world. That is the gospel that is preached. Teaching, on the other hand, is where you're laying the groundwork and building people up by telling them what God has to say in his word, that God loves you, that God is a forgiving God, that God is a holy God, and this is what God expects from us. And so as we're taught the things of the word of God, we are then built up in our faith. And so preaching and teaching are both important. Jesus taught, as it says here, in the synagogues. He went to the synagogues, the Jewish place of worship. We see Paul doing that in the book of Acts. Whenever he went into a new city, he went to the synagogue first. And so we see Jesus doing it actually in the Gospels as well, that he would go to the synagogues and that he would teach. In the synagogues, they would be scattered throughout the land of Israel, much different than the temple. The temple was not a teaching place. It was a place where you would bring your sacrifices and you would go on the feast days and the priest would offer up the sacrifices. But it wasn't a place that the scriptures were being taught. The synagogues were reserved for that. The synagogue service, kind of similar to what we have in a church service, but the idea is they would come in and there would be three aspects. There would be prayer, there would be the reading from the law and the prophets, and then there would be the address or the exhortation. And the president of the synagogue really was more of a facilitator. He wasn't the leader who would do the praying and the reading and the teaching, but he would be the one that would call upon those that would be fit, somebody from the congregation to come up and do the reading from the law and the prophets. And the fit person that was there to come up and give the address or the exhortation. So Jesus was called upon often to give the address in the synagogue. He went to the synagogues like Paul went to the synagogues. To the Jew first, and also to the Greek. I think it's just showing us how God was being faithful to go to his people and show them that he has fulfilled the promise that he made to them, that he would bring the Savior into the world. He went to the Jewish people first, and then oftentimes when they rejected it, the message would turn to the Gentiles. And so he was preaching, he was teaching, and he was healing. And it's not just like a healing crusade where a dozen people get healed. Everybody who was coming in faith was getting healed. And when they came, they were coming in faith. When you think about it, when you hear, especially at that time with not having the medicine that we have today, when we can all just go to the doctor, you know, when you can't just go to the doctor, when you hear that there is someone that is healing people of all kinds of physical diseases and mental diseases, and demon possession, they are coming from all over to be healed by him. Verse 24, then his fame went throughout all Syria, and they brought to him all sick people who were afflicted with various diseases and torments, and those who were demon possessed, epileptics and paralytics, and he healed them. Great multitudes followed him from Galilee and from Decapolis, Jerusalem, Judea, and beyond the Jordan. When you look at the map, it's not just Israel, but it's all of the nations that surround Israel. Today it would be Israel and Lebanon and Syria and Jordan. They're hearing about him because of all of these great healings that are taking place. And so people realize, you know, I want myself healed. I want my son or my daughter healed. And so they're making the trip. So you've got now vast multitudes that are coming to him, and it's laying the foundation. It's laying and giving him the platform to be able to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Isn't that cool? The multitudes are coming so that he can bring them this life-giving message, the message that John the Baptist gave, and the message that's going out today. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has drawn near. You come out today, let's say, and you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, the kingdom of heaven is drawn here in that the message has drawn near to you and given you and shown you the way of eternal life, and that is through faith in Jesus Christ. It's the message that was then, it's the message that's today. If you need Jesus, which if you don't know Jesus, then you need Jesus, then I encourage you just to call out to him and say, Lord, forgive me, for I am a sinner. save me. And that's the whole reason that Jesus came. If you'd like to pray, then we'll have people here that are at the end of the service that are here to pray with you. It's the most important thing that we can do is give our lives to the Lord. And it's the best decision that we could ever make. Amen? Amen. Why don't we stand for a closing word of prayer? Next week, we'll begin the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapters 5 through 7. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the time that we can have here in your word. Thank you that you not only have shown us the way so that we can have heaven with you, but you've shown us the way so that we can have a rich life here, even in the midst of a fallen world. And Father, I pray that your heart of comfort would be extended to those who have come out today, and that you would bring that assurance and that peace that only you can give. And Father, if there are any here that don't know you, I pray that they would come and receive your forgiveness today, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you all. Again, men, happy Father's Day. Have a blessed week.